Oh, it's great to see you out. Man, did the temperature jump? Woo, yesterday. That was unbelievable, but great to see you here. Hey, just out of curiosity, something just great happened in your world this week? Just one or two of something. Just something caught you by surprise and thrilled you? Yes, Bob. A clean bill of health. You went to the doctor? I'm sorry, Jeanette. Our prayers didn't work. That's good. Terrific. Yes, yeah.
I caught two burglars in a house.
You caught two burglars in a house. Were you trying to? Oh, you're okay. All right. Okay. Good. All right. I forgot that. All right. Yeah. Woo. That's good. Yes. Was it your house? She said, I get up every morning and I'm upright. All right, yeah, that's good. I heard somebody over at the 8 o'clock service say, somebody asked them how they were, and they said, well, you know, I got up this morning, I felt my right foot hit the floor, and I felt my left foot hit the floor, and I decided that's good enough to shower. So that was a novel approach. One more. Anything else? Just it was great for you this week. Yes? You are graduating from high school. That is right, all right? We got about, I think we've got 9 or 10 graduating from high school. We got a special Sunday scheduled in June. We'll be honoring all of our graduates. But, yeah, those who are graduating are already out of school, so that's awesome. There are still a few folks coming in, so if there's room on your pew, we got room on the front row. They love that one. There's a little room over here in the middle on the left. There's a little bit here in the center on the right, just kind of helping folks out. All right. Welcome. If you are a guest at New Hope for the very first time today, thank you. You honor us by your presence. There is a guest card in the pew in front of you. I would love for you to fill it out, drop it in the offering bag. Next week through the mail, we'll send you information. We promise we are not a harassing church, but we would like to get information in your hand that will answer a lot of questions. So thank you so very much for doing that. Let me, I don't know where the other clipboard is from the other service, so if one of the ushers would like to run over next door and get the other one. I'll get it started down the other side. Hopefully somebody's hearing all that. Yep, there he goes. There's two things on here. One of them you've seen for a couple of weeks. This is the Women's Secret Pal reveal this coming Saturday morning. If you've been a Secret Pal for the last 6 months, you want to come and find out who's been sending you cards and gifts. And if you've never been one, this is a great way to get introduced to other women in the church. Show up and you'll get one for the next 6 months. But they'd like to know you're coming so they have enough breakfast goodies for everybody. Underneath, Vacation Bible School is coming up very, very soon. If you would like to be a volunteer, you would like to help. And remember, I'm not using the word volunteer anymore around here. All right? The word around here now is, see, volunteers, you're going to help another organization. Do you volunteer to help your family? No, you make yourself available to serve your family. And so around here, we're looking for folks who are going to be available to serve God in whatever areas are available to us. And one is Vacation Bible School. And so on June the 14th, there's going to be an information meeting at 12:30. That's a Sunday, so after church. Thank you very much, Robert. He is all over that. They would love for you to sign up so they have enough lunch for you that day. And they'll let you know all the various ways you can serve. You can be a crew leader. You can be involved in kitchen snacks, crafts, games, music, teaching. You got all kinds of ways to help set up, clean up. There's all kinds of ways to be of service. So those are the two sign-up sheets, and they are going around at this moment. Last night, saw a great movie here at the church. How many of you forgot? Okay. 8 o'clock service, we had about 10. Okay, I got two hands going up. I have an announcement to make that was sent to me by Corey just a few minutes ago. And it says, here is a recap of last night. Because you remember the little challenge went down? Though it was a free movie, one small group challenged us to bring packages of new underwear, all right, for a service project that one small group was doing. Another one challenged folks to a dessert contest so we would have goodies to eat after the movie was over. Ooh, there were some good sweets, man. There were some good stuff. So here's a recap. The Lewis small group won the dessert contest, okay? So Kathy and Julie. Julie, are you in here? I'm sorry, Kathy, stand up. Kathy and Julie tied for the best dessert, all right? So outstanding, guys, outstanding. Rich and Regina's small group brought the most underwear, all right? And Corey said, and I had fun. All right, so that was how last night went. It was an excellent, excellent movie. We did have 5 unplanned intermissions. Our high school kids were out in the foyer selling goodies, so we thought it was good to have intermissions so they could sell more product. Actually, the filter on the machine up there got clogged, and so it shut down about every 20 minutes, and we would have to reboot, but it worked out well. We made it, and it was a good movie. Let me highlight a few other announcements and then a couple of prayer requests, and we'll get engaged in our worship. I'm holding these tickets in my hand. This is raffle tickets my height, okay? I've always wished I was taller, but never more than moments like this, all right? For $20, you can get your height and raffle tickets. This is 35 tickets, so it was a good deal. It was better than $1 a ticket. They're available out there today. Even if you're not coming back tonight, you can buy raffle tickets. Go by, put them in the various things that you might like to win. All right, if there's something out there you really want, buy 20 and put them all in one. Your chances go up. All right, that way. Here's the deal. Here's what's important. If you're not going to be here tonight, put your name and your phone number on it. Okay. If you don't put your name and phone number on it and it gets drawn and we call the number and you're not here, we will just throw that ticket away and draw another one because we have no way of contacting you, okay? So if you can't be here tonight but you want to win something, just put your name and your phone number on the ticket. After the service, when you buy these, put them in the various containers out there. When you win, you will actually win, all right? If you're going to be back tonight, then you don't have to take the time and the effort to write your name and phone number on it. Just listen when your number is called, all right, and then you can win all those things. And these actually are Shelly's tickets, so I get to give them back to her now, okay? Next thing I want to talk about, if you haven't bought dinner tickets for tonight, you can buy those today out there. They're $5 a piece, or if your family's bigger than 4, $20, okay? So 4 or more in your immediate family. In other words, you can't bring all your nieces and nephews for $20, all right? So if your immediate family, you got 5 or 6 in your immediate family, it's $20 for the whole family, all right? Otherwise, $5 a ticket. Those are available out there today. Oh, yeah, Fresno Grizzlies. I have 2 tickets here to a Grizzlies game Tuesday. It's a noon game. Starts at 12:05, all right? So I know that limits who might be available, but these are good seats. Would somebody like these 2 tickets for a Grizzlies game 12:05 on Tuesday? If you're in high school, I cannot give them to you. You cannot ditch school, all right? Anybody want these 2 tickets? Okay, if you do afterwards, let me know. I know the time makes it hard, all right? Time makes it hard. Okay. Little family time. I haven't had an opportunity to do this with the series that we were in, so I'm taking a little extra time today. As you can tell, the bulletin has been getting spruced up, making some changes. Last week, there were no prayer requests in there. That was not intended to be a permanent thing. Just we're redoing some things. I did share with you a few weeks ago. If you've been here very long, you've noticed that the prayer thing just keeps getting longer and longer, and the print keeps getting smaller and smaller. And there were complaints about that. Can't read it, okay? Can't keep up with it. So we're doing 2 or 3 different things. Number one, all those prayer requests are posted on our website. And it's very easy. You go to the opening page of the website. It says prayer right on the right-hand corner. Click on it. There they all are, all right? Now, we realize not all of you are computer conscious, okay? So we know that's an issue. So we will be printing that off every month, and they will be on the tables in the back so that you can get a printed sheet. We are going to keep in the bulletin prayer requests for 2 to 3 weeks, and then we will move them to the big list that's on the computer, and those will be available in the back of the church. Here is where you can help us, okay? You give us prayer requests on these cards. You call them and leave them, but if we don't have names and phone numbers, we have no way of knowing when that prayer request expires. And I mean that both literally and figuratively, okay? This is sad, and I hate it when it happens to us. There have been occasions we've had somebody on a prayer request list who's already been in heaven for 3 months, okay? They don't need our prayer anymore, all right? They're doing really, really good right now. But we didn't know that because it's not always people in our church. There are people in our church who are asking us to pray for somebody else, and we don't know if you don't tell us. Or somebody had surgery, and it's for recovery. Recoveries can be 1 week. Recoveries can be 6 months, okay? So we just don't like taking names out without being told. So you can help us a lot by telling us, all right, that prayer request has expired, okay? So that can be of a big, big help. Number two, and here's an example. Somebody gave me one today. We get, some of you use the cards in the pew for both compliments to staff and also constructive direction, okay? And we appreciate and value both of them, all right? They carry a lot more weight and influence if you put your name and phone number on it. Some of you are saying, I want to complain and be anonymous, okay? Please understand, there are things that for example, somebody put in last week, and we didn't have an announcement, the bulletin was impersonal. Okay, I would have loved to have been able personally to have called and said thank you, all right? But number two, I could have also shared with you, that's not ongoing. We are making some changes. Here is the format. Do you have other suggestions for us? It's obviously an interest of yours, so you're a person I want to talk to. So if you put a phone number on here, we can call. This is not to get you to change your mind. This is to help us. Because you will have ideas that staff doesn't think about. Same thing with compliments. You compliment something. If we can sometimes follow up with you, that helps us in our preparation the next time around. So it doesn't mean you can't stay anonymous, but it really is more helpful and it does carry more weight, all right? And the flip side of that is if you've turned in very many of these, I now know your handwriting. So you're not anonymous anymore anyway, all right? Anyway, that just would be helpful, okay? So thank you very much for that. That was just some housekeeping things. Let me highlight a few other things coming up. I've already hit the Secret Pal event. A week from this Tuesday is the senior luncheon. Special guests, Phil Wright and Lonnie Rolen, all right, on the honor flight. And you'll see pictures and hear some of their stories. So that will be exciting. And they're going to be our guests also at the men's breakfast on June the 13th. Graduation Sunday is June the 14th. We'll recognize all of our high school graduates and college graduates that day. So thank you very much for that. And you can take advantage of the other things that are on there. Do we have some pictures also of some young ladies being baptized? Here we go. Last week you heard me mention that you were responsible as a church family through the connection that Kathy Lewis provided for us. There are 25 young mothers, teenage mothers, that an outreach of one of our teen ministries in town participates in, and Kathy is one of those leaders, and they provide mentors. 15 of those 25 young teenage moms have given their life to Christ, and they were all baptized a week ago last Thursday night, and that's exciting. The young lady that Kathy mentored, she bought her a Bible the week before in honor of her baptism coming up and had her name engraved on it, and she loved it, and all the other girls, and they were envious. And I don't think it's good to start out right after baptism being jealous. And so Kathy made a suggestion that maybe New Hope could buy 14 more Bibles and get the girls' names engraved on it. And so we did that, and Kathy was able to take them to that event and give them to all the girls. And so we wanted you to see a few of those pictures today. And so that's exceptional. So we are very, very grateful for that. At this time, I'm going to ask our usher, dinner's tonight at what time? 5:30, pasta feed right outside these doors. Raffle right after that. You'll be home early this evening. Hope you come out and join us, all right? Let's pray, and we'll get engaged in our worship today. Father, this thing that we call life can sometimes be really tricky. Sometimes you can have a week that is really, really quiet. Things go very smoothly. And then all of a sudden, in the middle of a very quiet, restful week, the fasten your seatbelt sign shows up because there's turbulence ahead. Sometimes it catches us off guard, but it ought to never catch us unprepared. Sometimes it may catch us off guard, but Father, it never catches you by surprise. And so I trust, Father, that we're learning in growing measure more and more what it is to trust you through both the days and the weeks of quiet consistency, as well as to trust you in the midst of those surprise, turbulent occasions. You are the God who is big enough for it all. And Lord, we need to remember to trust you both in the quiet days as well as in the excitable days. We share with you the needs of this church family, those who are going through treatment because of cancer, those who are recovering from surgeries. Lord, those who are waiting for what the next decision about surgery is going to be. We trust you for each of those needs. for those who have recently experienced death or loss in their life. May they sense your presence and experience your comfort in ways that are beyond their wildest imagination. Father, thank you for this month of transition as seniors in high school are graduating and they're going to become college students, or they're going to make transition into a career or a professional field that they want to pursue. As college students graduate from their formal education and make decisions about where they're going to invest the rest of their life. Father, this month of transition, may it be one in which you are the heartbeat and the focus of this time of transformation in their lives. Father, for the privilege of giving and sharing, we say thank you. We do so not out of obligation, but we do so out of great love. We don't do it, Father, because we're trying to play a game to win favor with you, but we do it because we have experienced your favor in our lives. We do it as a tribute to the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, and the difference that his risen life makes in our own. We share because we care about the needs of others, loving our neighbors both across town as well as around the world. So thank you for the privilege today of one more time giving testimony to your faithfulness to us. We surrender all this to you in the awesome, matchless name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Psychiatry students were in their college class one day when their professor began a discussion with the interest of proving a point. He said, "What we're going to talk about today are the emotional extremes that mentally distraught people go through. For example," he said, "what's the opposite of joy?" And a student responded, "Sadness." He looked at another student and said, "What's the opposite of depression?" She said, "Elation." Turning to a young man who happened to be from Texas, he said, "What's the opposite of woe?" Y'all are ahead of me on this one, aren't you? He said, "Well, now, I suppose the opposite of woe is giddy up. Giddy up." Yeah, all right. Well, last week, as we started talking about what do we do when the fasten your seatbelt sign goes on, we discovered it means one of three things. On an airplane, it means you're taking off, you're landing, or you are experiencing turbulence in mid-flight. All three of these are critical times when you're flying. They are transition times. In the case of taking off, most of us know what to expect. In the case of landing, most of us have been there, done that before. But experiencing turbulence in mid-flight, we often discover we are out of control. And we have no idea what's next. And about that moment, when the turbulence gets a little rough and you have strapped on the seatbelt, you're beginning to reflect, maybe I should have paid more attention to those pre-flight instructions. Where is that nearest exit? Where is that flotation device? Where am I? Should I really have taken this seat in the aisle of the exit? I got to be honest, that's the one thing I pay attention to, who's sitting in that row, because everybody has to give a verbal response, "Yes, I am able to do this." I have seen numerous people sit in that aisle that I do not believe are able to help me get out the plane, all right? That bothers me just a wee bit. But when the fasten your seatbelt sign comes on in life, in turbulent moments of life, last week we looked at what should our first response be. Do you remember what it was? Pray. Good. Four of you remembered. Prayer. That's our first response. And though we may go to that internal quiet place, we often pray with the hopes that things will change. And what we often discover when we log time with God in turbulent moments of life and we pray, what we discover is that God rarely changes the circumstances, but he most frequently changes us. Prayer isn't about changing things. Prayer is about being changed. Changed to trust the Father with the things that only he can control. Change so that we are free from decisions that will complicate our lives. Change because we have placed our lives into God's hands And God's hands are capable of handling our life. Today we want to talk about the second thing that we should do when the fasten your seatbelt sign goes on and we discover again that we are not in control of this world. I'd invite you to turn to a book in the Old Testament called 1 Kings. 1 Kings, find chapter 16. We're going to be looking at verses in 16, 17, 18, and 19. 1 Kings is very easy to find. It's on the left side of your Bible. It's in the Old Testament. It's right in front of 2 Kings. Yeah, that's the reason there's a 1 Kings, all right, is there's a second one. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Ruth, and 2 Samuel, yeah, 1 Kings. All right, you're right there. So find chapter 16, and we'll be getting there in just a couple of minutes. We, over the next several minutes, are going to look at my favorite all-time Bible hero, all right, particularly out of the Old Testament. His name is Elijah. When looking ahead makes us fearful, we not only need to pray, but we should also look back in our past and remember. Prayer and remembering go hand in hand. There are some things in our life that we have forgotten. There are some things in our life that we need to forget. There are also some things in our life that we forgot to remember to know. We've known them, we've experienced it, and now when the fasten the seatbelt light comes on, you and I panic and we forget to remember lessons learned. Remembering is sometimes hard work, as illustrated by the three elderly sisters who lived together. One sister got up to go up to bed. Halfway up the stairs, she stopped on the landing and she asked her other two sisters, "Am I going up or was I going down?" The one sister replied with a hint of aggravation, "You're going to bed." "Oh, yeah." The other sister, who was still downstairs, headed to the kitchen. She wanted to make herself a sandwich. Once in the kitchen, she hollered back to her sister, who was still downstairs, "What did I come in the kitchen for?" The sister responded, this time more annoyed than ever, "You went to make a sandwich." The last remaining sister in the living room said, "I am so glad I am not forgetful as both of you." She knocked on the wood on the table next to the couch. She then got up and walked to the front door and said, "Who is it?" I know that's a little too close for some of you, isn't it? Yeah, I'm sorry. But there are some things that we would love to forget. There are things that we can't afford to forget. Uncertainty has a way of focusing us so exclusively on the mystery of what lies before us that we forget about those things that were behind us. If you've been a Christian for any length of time, God's faithfulness in your life in the past will cast a wonderful shadow into your future. God's faithfulness to us in the past should shape our assurance and our perspective about the future. We should learn to rest in the comfort of His shadow. So when the fasten the seatbelt sign comes on this week, we must remember to not forget God's past provisions. Would you pause with me for just a moment? Let your mind wander back, and you're doing this intentionally today. Let your mind wander back to a moment when there was turbulence in your life, and you experienced a peace of God that is indescribable. You've experienced the joy of God that's unexplainable. You've experienced the comfort of God that was beyond your wildest imagination. When it wasn't logical to be at peace, when it wasn't logical to have a sense of joy, when it wasn't logical to be comforted. Can you capture a memory of when that happened for you? I can. I can think of three or four of them, right? That is an extremely valuable weapon you have in your arsenal to defeat the enemy of discouragement and despondency and depression and fear. is knowing how God has been there in the past. You have a track record with Him and His sufficiency in past circumstances of life. We're going to look at a life of a man today who forgot and forgot very quickly. I hope that will encourage you that there is a Bible hero who blew it. Okay? But the wonderful thing we'll see is that when we blow it, God is there to pick us up. And God is there to remind us of what we should have remembered. And He takes us on to the next place in life. What we don't want to have happen is an ongoing forgetful problem, to where every time the fasten your seatbelt sign comes on, we resort back to fear, frustration, and anxiety. We want to create a new set of habits that when the fasten your seatbelt sign comes on, you say as you hook up, "Wow, wonder what He's going to do this time." So we pray. Number two, we remember. Let's look back at the life of Elijah. When the turbulence hit Elijah in mid-flight and the fasten your seatbelt light flashed in his world, what did Elijah do? He panicked. He panicked. So let's turn to 1 Kings 16, 17, 18, and 19. I've had some people tell me over the years, "I don't believe these stories about Elijah right here. I mean, I don't believe that a raven fed him. I don't believe that a widow's barrel of meal never went dry. I just find it hard to believe." Here's the deal. Don't believe me. Do you believe Jesus? Because Jesus referred back to these very stories in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 4, in one of his own sermons. So I'm going to kind of hang with Jesus on this one, all right? I believe this all happened. The context of what's going on in history at this moment is we are about 7 decades after Solomon was king of Israel. You had King Saul, you had King David, you had King Solomon, and they were the king over the 12 tribes of Israel. After Solomon, a couple of people got in a fight over who was going to be king. They got in a, all right, sound a little bit like church can sometimes, okay? And so they split. And so now you have two kingdoms. You have the kingdom of Israel and you have the kingdom of Judah, yeah. And so each of them now had their own set of kings. They couldn't get along together, so they split. When Israel, after this time on, when Israel had no godly king, God would send a prophet to be the mouthpiece for him in the midst of the people. When the king should have been leading the spiritual course of his people, when they failed in that, God would send a prophet. So when Ahab turned against God, who in this chapter, beginning at chapter 16, 17, 18, King Ahab is now the king, God sends a prophet by the name of Elijah. Let me just set a little bit more context, okay? So kind of keep your Bible open. We're going to stay focused in it a lot this morning. If you notice in chapter 16, if you want to jump in at about verse 7, the word of the Lord came through the prophet Jehu, son of Hanani, to Baasha in his house, Baasha's the king, because of all the evil done in the eyes of the Lord. You drop down to verse 13, all right, and now Elah is king of Israel. Because of the sins of Baasha and his son Elah caused Israel to commit, so they provoked the Lord and the God of Israel to anger by their worthless idols. You drop down now to the next section, Zimri, king of Israel, verse 19. Because of the sins he had committed, doing evil in the eyes of the Lord, walking in the ways of Jeroboam. Drop down to Omri, the next king of Israel, verse 25. But Omri did evil in the eyes of the Lord and sinned more than all those before him. Isn't that a distinction you would like to have? One right after the other. Did evil in the sight of God. Now we get to Ahab. That's where we are now time-wise. Verse 30. Ahab, son of Omri. Remember, Omri did more evil than anybody before him? The acorn doesn't fall far from the tree. Ahab, son of Omri, did more evil in the eyes of the Lord than any of those before him. His father had set the mark, man, and Ahab was shooting for it. And he reached it. He had been the most evil king ever in Israel. So Elijah is sent to do what Ahab could not do. Ahab was the most wicked king Israel had up to that point in time. He was the eighth king of Israel. This is about 70 years after Solomon and the split. Some of the things that Ahab had done that did not honor God, verse 31, he married Jezebel, a foreign woman. Now, New Hope has their own version of Jezebel, all right? She is about to celebrate her 100th birthday, all right, up in Oregon. Remember, they moved away from us a couple of years ago, but she's about next month to celebrate her 100th birthday. There's a story, don't have time to tell it, of why she got nicknamed Jezebel, all right? Nothing similar to this one, okay? Very, very different. But Jezebel should have never been married to King Ahab. Do you know why? She was not an Israelite. God told the king, hey, don't marry outside of Israel, all right? And they did. In fact, you'll find that in verse 31. He not only considered it trivial to commit the sins of Jeroboam, son of Nebat, but he also married Jezebel, daughter of Ethbaal, king of the Sidonians. And he, Ahab, began to serve Baal and worship him, all because of his wife. His wife established Baal worship as the national religion, and she pretty much wore the in the country. That was Jezebel. Ahab also rebuilt Jericho, which was against the will of God. God said after the walls came tumbling down, when Joshua brought him into the promised land, he said, Jericho is never to be built again. Ahab did. It didn't last long. In fact, if you want to do a fun archaeological study, Google Jericho and read about its rebuilding. Read about how the scriptures help the archaeologists figure out what went on there. It's pretty fascinating stuff. Verse 30, he did more to provoke the Lord than all the kings before him. That's Ahab. Now, God sends Elijah to warn Ahab, and then God is going to take care of Elijah. Let's jump in at chapter 17, verse 1. Now, Elijah the Tishbite from Tishbe in Gilead said to Ahab, as the Lord God of Israel lives. Elijah is blunt, but I think he also has an incredible sense of humor. Who is Ahab worshiping? What have we just read about? Baal, all right? Baal is the god of the Sidonians. He is not the god of the Israelites. Elijah is sort of poking a knife in the side of Ahab. I am Elijah the Tishbite. I am a prophet for the God of Israel. The God who brought Israel out of Egypt, through the wilderness, through the Red Sea, over the Jordan River, and put them here. And that's the God, now he sticks the knife in, he's the God I serve. Ahab, the God who's responsible for the kingdom that you are now leading, that you have nothing to do with, he's the God I am here to represent in your presence. And what does my God have to say to you and your God? There will neither be dew nor rain in the next few years, except at my word. I see a smirk on Elijah's face. If you do again, if you want to Google the name Baal, you'll find that Baal is classified as the god of a couple of different things. He's referred to on some occasions as the storm god. So Elijah says, okay, my God who is the God of Israel is going to stop rain in your world. See if your storm god can overrule the God of Israel. A little humor in that, isn't there? It's one of the reasons, and a few of you have heard me say it around here, it's one of the reasons I'm careful about whether I'm praying to God to end the drought in California. Because God sent a drought to Israel for the purpose of getting the attention of their leaders who were living in rebellion against him. Sometimes drastic measures need to occur to get leadership to understand they are not in control. And God very well may be holding it from this part of the country until our leadership begins to understand they're not in charge. Let me move on. Elijah announces there'll be no rain for several years. That's verses 1 and 2. And then notice what God does for Elijah. Verse 2, then the word of the Lord came to Elijah, leave here. God sends him somewhere else. God sent him to Ahab, now he sends him somewhere else. Where does he send him? He said, go to the Kereth Ravine east of the Jordan. You will drink from the brook. I would have been, if I was Elijah, I'd have been saying, God, how long is that brook going to flow with no rain? But he says, I want you to go there, and I'm going to feed you with ravens. I remember last time it might have been the last time, but one of the first times I preached on that here, we went to the Promise Keepers in Anaheim, and you took a picture in Anaheim Stadium of a raven circling, all right, the ballpark, coming down looking for something to scavenge. Ravens are scavengers. How would you like God to tell you, I've got one of my own private maids who's going to serve you your meal every day, and it's a scavenger? I've always wondered, what kind of meat did the raven bring? Hey, but he fed him every day. So what did Elijah do? Next verse tells us, he did what the Lord told him. When God sent him, he went. And by the way, folks, that's always very, very good advice. When God sends, go. And he says, stay there. And the ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning and bread and meat in the evening, and he drank from the brook. Some time later, don't know how long, but some time later, the brook dried up because there was no rain. And the word of the Lord came to him, go. Next verse. So he went. Where did he go? This is fascinating. He went to Zarephath. What does it tell us? Where is Zarephath? He came to the town gate. A widow was gathering sticks. Go at once to Zarephath. Go back up to verse 9. Go at once to Zarephath of where? Sidon. Go back over to verse 31 of chapter 16. Who lived there? Ahab's in-laws. All my years of reading this passage, never discovered this. Never realized Elijah was sent back into enemy territory of Jezebel. This is where her family lived, the Sidonians. He wasn't in Israel. He was in the country of the enemies, and that is where God provided for him. God provides and protects his person in the heart of enemy territory. Provision is not about the place. It is about the person. That is the reason that you and I live in this world, and the old hymn says it this way, this world is not my home. But in the midst of this world that still has a dominance of satanic influence in it, you and I do not have anything to be afraid of the turbulence in this world, not because of where we are, but because of whose we are. Because of this relationship we have with a person. Meanwhile, unbeknownst to him, Ahab is searching everywhere for Elijah. 3 years later, God's going to send Elijah right to the guy who's looking for him. And he goes to tell him, Ahab, it's about to rain again. Your storm god had nothing to do with turning the valve off, and he has nothing to do with turning the valve on. The God of creation is the only one who can do that. So God sends Elijah to Ahab a second time. The first time, to announce a drought. The second time, to announce rain. By this time, Ahab is angry and desperate because the people are frustrated with no rain. Elijah challenges at this moment, what this next chapter is all about, is Elijah challenging the prophets of Baal and Asheroth to a duel to prove which one is the Lord God. Ahab has got 450 prophets of Baal. He's got 400 prophets of Asheroth. And Elijah says, you get your 850 prophets, take him to the top of Mount Carmel, and I'm ready for a duel. And Ahab says, okay. You see, once and for all, God is going to give a graphic lesson to everybody of who really is God. And so it gets set up. Most of you know the story, but for those of you who don't, let me fill it in real quick. Elijah says, okay, here's the deal. Bring two bulls up here. You all are going to prepare an altar, and you're going to prepare a bull, and you're going to get to pray to your God to consume the sacrifice. You do not set a fire. I will also build an altar. I will prepare my bull, and then I will pray to the God of Israel. And whichever God answers will be the real, true, and living God. Everybody said, okay, let's do it. Here was the deal. Elijah said, don't start your own fire. God must start the fire. And by the way, folks, that's always good advice for us, spiritually. Don't start your own religion. Don't try to start your own revival. Let God create the fire in your heart. Let it fall from heaven into your heart. It makes all the difference in the world, the source of the fire in your life. Yours will go out. Yours will not be all-consuming. His will be. And so then we find ourselves at this battle. That is begins at verse, let's see here. We're going to jump in at verse 22. Let me back up, 20. So Ahab sent word throughout all of Israel, assembled the prophets on Mount Carmel. Elijah went before the people, and he looked at the congregation, and he said, how long will all of you waver between two opinions? The sacrifice hadn't happened yet, and Elijah wants to know whose side you're on. Before the turbulence ever comes, whose side are you on? If Baal is God, then follow him. If Jehovah God is God, then follow him. Somebody want to read what the people responded? Yeah, they did exactly what you just did. They said nothing. Nothing. Verse 21, last phrase. But the people said nothing. Then Elijah said to them, I am the only one of the Lord's prophets left. There's a little chink right there. You just catch a glimpse. Remember this. There's a little chink in Elijah's armor right here. I'm the only one left. But Baal has a whole bunch of prophets left. Get two bulls, and then he explains what the duel is going to be. And then we jump in and notice what happens. Elijah said to the prophets of Baal, choose one of the bulls, prepare it. Then they called on the name of Baal from morning till noon. That's probably from 8 till 12, 4 hours. Oh, Baal, answer us! No response. They danced around the altar. At noon, Elijah began to become irritating to them. He taunted them. He said, shout louder! Surely he's a god. Perhaps he's in deep thought or busy or traveling. Maybe your god is sleeping and needs to be awakened. So they shouted louder. They slashed themselves with swords and spears, as was their custom, until blood flowed. Midday passed. That's 3 o'clock. They continued their frantic prophesying until the time of evening sacrifice, probably 6. But there was no response. No one answered. No one paid attention. Then Elijah said to all the people, hey, come over to our side. They came to him. He repaired the altar of the Lord, which was in ruins. You see, they had built altars to Baal and Asheroth. They had let the altar of God be laid to waste. Elijah rebuilt it. He built it out of 12 stones, one for each tribe. He descended that descended from Jacob, and he said, your name shall be Israel. With the stones, he built an altar in the name of the Lord, and he dug a trench around it large enough to hold 2 seahs of seed. He arranged the wood, cut the bull in pieces, laid it on the wood, and then he said to them, fill 4 large jars with water. Pour it on the offering and on the wood. Do it again, he said. And they did it again. Do it a third time, he ordered. And they did it a third time. Any idea why he used 12 jars of water? One for each tribe. All of you were involved in this. All of you were connected to this. At the time of the sacrifice, the prophet Elijah stepped forward and he prayed, O Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known today that you are the God of Israel. And that I am your servant, done as you have commanded. Answer me, O Lord, answer me so these people will know that you, O Lord, are God, and that you are turning their hearts back again. Then the fire of the Lord fell. It burned up the sacrifice, the wood. Have you ever seen stones burned up? That is one hot fire, folks. Stones, the soil. It licked up the water in the trench. This was an all-consuming sacrifice. When the people saw this, they fell and cried, the Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God. Sounds cool, doesn't it? It's not. You know what they didn't say? He is our God. They didn't understand. David said, the Lord is who? My shepherd. It's one thing to acknowledge that God exists. It's another thing to acknowledge him as your Lord and Savior. Then Elijah commanded them, seize the prophets of Baal. Don't let anyone get away. They seized them, and Elijah had them brought down to the Kishon Valley and slaughtered there. And you say, man, that sounds brutal. Yes, but remember, before real revival comes, We must rid ourselves of all deception. Elijah wasn't going to let those who had deceived the nation now for decades to continue to exist. He wanted revival to flourish. So, here's Elijah. He has proclaimed the truth. He has brought fire down from heaven. He now goes and he prays, and rain begins to fall. And he tells Ahab, you better hurry home, because even Houston hasn't seen a flood like this. If you don't go now, you won't make it home. So Ahab jumps in his chariots, and his horse-drawn chariot is heading for home. And Ahab picks up the corner of his coat, and he sticks it in his belt. And Ahab outruns a horse-drawn chariot 10 miles to town. Ahab gets home, and he can't wait to tell Jezebel what happened. I almost think Ahab's excited about this. Ahab's excited because the pressure's off his back, because it's raining. Okay, the duel, okay, I can live with that. We lost, okay. So he's telling Jezebel, man, let me tell you, okay, you've never seen anything like what Elijah did. Call fire down. And then he took all your 800 prophets and he had them slaughtered. Her face exploded like a hot thermometer. She said, I will do to him what he did to my prophets. And word got to Elijah how mad Jezebel was. Notice what happened in verse 3 of chapter 19. Elijah was afraid and ran for his life. This is the first time in 3 chapters we see Elijah going anywhere where God had not sent him. He ran out of fear. The fasten your seatbelt sign came on. It didn't mean he was to run. You and I, when the fasten your seat, we don't jump out of the plane. We stay in our seat. Elijah wasn't to run. He was to fasten his seatbelt. He was to pray, and he was to remember God's providence. But he forgot. Hours after great victory, he runs in fear. Jezebel threatens, and he runs because he forgot to remember. In his distress, what's God going to do? Notice verse 5. Actually, I should back up and listen to him. I've had enough, Lord. Take my life. I'm no better than my ancestors. He's whining. And then he lays down and he goes to sleep under the tree. An angel touches him and says, get up and eat. I love the way God deals with him right here. He wakes him up. After rest, he provides him breakfast. God gave him grace. This is the loving kindness of an agitated God. God's disappointed in Elijah right here, but he doesn't take the disappointment out on Elijah. He gives him rest. He gives him nourishment. And then he gives him a nap. And then he wakes him up again and he gives him lunch again. You see, God doesn't hit us when we're down. He nurtures us. It's what David said when he leads me into green pastures and he leads me beside still waters. And when I get rest and when I get nourishment, my soul begins to get restored. And then what does Elijah do? Verses 8 and 9. He runs for another 40 days. In the strength of the last meal God gave him, Elijah keeps running away from his problems. You see, Elijah's interpretation of the uncertainty around him left him unafraid. Here was a man who had called fire down from heaven. Here is a man who had stopped the rain. And he is now a man who is running from a woman. As we look, and as God looked at Elijah's circumstances, we are thinking, Elijah, how could you do this? After all that God has just provided for you, how can you run now? Elijah, you were in control of that situation. No, God was in control, but you were his man. You were there. You had the upper hand of this situation. God implies, as I see it, Elijah, you were right where I wanted you to be. And you ran. But as Elijah looked at the same set of circumstances, this is the difference between upper story perspective and lower story perspective. God's perspective was, Elijah, you're right where you need to be, man. We are going to take care of Jezebel once and for all. But you ran. You see, as Elijah looks at the same circumstances, he's saying, as I see it, I've done all I can do. As I see it, there is no more hope. There's no light at the end of the tunnel anymore. As I see it, I'm all alone. And how long will I be all alone? as I see it, nothing is going to change. You ever feel like that in your world? Lower story perspective? Then God gave Elijah a not so gentle reminder, beginning at verse 15 of the 19th chapter. God gave Elijah a not so gentle reminder of who he was and what he could do should he choose to do so. Then he asked Elijah one more time, as if to say, in light of who I am and what I can do, God asked Elijah a question. He asked this question twice. He asked it in verse 9. What are you doing here, Elijah? Where was Elijah now? I'm sorry, I skipped that part of the story. When he ran for 40 days and 40 nights, where did he end up? Mount Horeb. What happened at Mount Horeb? What big event happened at Mount Horeb? It's where Moses was given the law. It's known as the place of God, the mountain of God. That's where he ran. If you're going to run somewhere, it's good to go to the place of God. And that's where Elijah ran. Wasn't where God wanted him at that moment, but it was there God spoke to him and he said, what are you doing here? What are you doing here? After some dialogue, next page, next verse, I believe it's verse 13, he asks him again, what are you doing here? You see, Elijah misses it both times. So now God informs Elijah of his plans, the plans that God had been working behind the scenes all along. Before Elijah ever ran, God was already at work orchestrating things. Elijah was not alone. You're going to see two more times in this chapter, Elijah says, I'm the last prophet you got left, God. Just kill me and be done with it. Really, Elijah? Really? Have you ever said to God, I'm the last one left who does good? I'm the last one left who trusts God. Nobody trusts God like I do. God informs Elijah, here's what's been going on. He said, Elijah, I want you to get off this mountain, and I've chosen a new king. I want you to go anoint him. Elijah, since you think you're the last one left, I've chosen your successor. I want you to go meet him. And Elijah, just so you know, there are 7,000 faithful believers of mine in Israel. Stop having a pity party. You are not alone. Go meet your brothers and sisters. I could almost hear Elijah backing up saying, whoa, Lord, you've been busier than I thought. You've been busy. Elijah had two problems here. There were some things that he forgot about. Are there some things that you've forgotten about in your past where God has provided? The other thing Elijah had was there were some things that he didn't know about. He didn't know God was doing behind the scenes. If he had remembered how God provided in the past, he'd be better prepared for the unseen things of God in his future. But when we forget what God has done in our past, we do not contemplate the things he might do in our future. Because he forgot God's past faithfulness, he had a difficult time factoring in future faithfulness. Because he didn't know what was going on, he assumed nothing was going on. When we lose sight of God's past work in our life, we don't factor his work into our future either. And our fear can drive us to places we have no business going, relationally and financially and emotionally. As we remember him in our past, we will see his fingerprints in our future. Let me wrap this up. I want you to notice what God did for Elijah in this moment of turbulence in his life that was caused by not remembering. He did four things. One, God sent him to church. He sent him to Mount Horeb. And there he hung out in a cave, but he wasn't supposed to stay in the cave. Number two, God had Elijah tell him, what's your problem? God wants you to confess your sins to him. Number three, God dealt with the false beliefs and false ideas that were fueling Elijah's depression. Once you articulate, God can then provide you some answers. And last of all, God gave Elijah something to do. Let's wrap this up. Do you know why circumstances put us under the table emotionally and physically? It's because we anticipate the future with no thought of God's faithfulness in our past. And as a result, we forget that he is working behind the scenes of our life. Number two, when the future is uncertain, pray and remember. Number three, when looking ahead makes you fearful, look back. Look back. Number four, there are things you have forgotten, and there are things you don't know about. Number five, when we place the uncertainty of the future in the context of His faithfulness, not ours, but His in the past, and His promises of care in the future, you and I can experience rest in the present. And number six, when I worship, I rehearse God's past faithfulness. I think back in detail over what God has done. I want to close with two questions that were in the reading that we finished today. In chapter 18, verse 21, Elijah asked the people who gathered that day this question, "How long will you waver between two opinions? If Baal is God, follow him. If God is God, follow him." Some of you have been coming to New Hope, I'm pretty confident, for months, maybe years. You've dabbled. You've gotten your fingers wet. But you've made no decision. Isn't it time to get off the fence? Isn't it time to stop being apathetic and make a choice? Move away from apathy and trust Christ. The second question, are for those of us who are believers, and this question is found in verse 9 and 13 of chapter 19. And God asked Elijah this question twice, and he asks it of you today. What are you doing here? What are you doing here? Some of you are on the sidelines. Others of you are in the cave. And here's the deal. If you sit in the cave too long, you will not walk in the Spirit and you will run on empty in life. My challenge to you is this. Don't stay where you are. Walk in the Spirit of Christ every moment of every day. What are you doing here? Max Lucado puts it well. In one of his books, he said, God likes you just the way you are, but He loves you too much to let you stay that way. God's got more for us. So when the fasten your seatbelt sign shows up in midlife, mid-flight, when it gets a little rocky in your world, it's not your landing, it's not your takeoff, and it's not your landing, what do? First response is pray. Second response is remember. Come back next week and find out what's the third thing you're supposed to do. Let's pray. Father, for those who are answering the question right now with you, how long will you waver between two opinions? What are you doing here? You are listening with a very attentive ear to every one of our answers. Both questions deserve an answer. Thank you, Father, for the way that you will lead us to the right answers. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Through the double doors is the pavilion. You will find coffee out there. You will find tickets for pasta dinner tonight. You will find raffle items.